this morning entitled, Your Word is a Weapon. Your word is a weapon. If you'll turn in your Bibles to the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 30, I want to begin reading in verse 15. I want to read verses 15 and 16, and then I'm going to go down to 19 and 20. Deuteronomy chapter 30, I'm going to be, verse 15 reads this way. See, somebody say see. I have set before you today life and good. Somebody say life and good. I like life when it's good. Somebody say amen. You see, I've set before you today life and good, comma, death and evil. In that I command you today to love the Lord your God. Amen. To walk in his ways. And to keep his commandments, his statutes, his judgments. That you may live and multiply. Amen. And the Lord your God will bless you.
Amen.
Now it goes on after that to tell what God's going to do if you don't obey. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
But I'm going to spare you that this morning.
Amen.
And go to verse 19. And it says, I call heaven and earth as witnesses today against you. In other words, he went through to say, what's going to happen if you didn't obey? And then he come back and he said, now I call heaven and earth against you today against you that I have set before you. And he begins to talk about what he said in verse 15. And I set before you life and death. Blessing and cursing, comma, therefore choose life, that both of you and your descendants may live. How many would rather choose life over death? How many would rather choose health over sickness? How many would rather replace plenty with want? Therefore, choose life that both you and your descendants may live, that you may love the Lord your God, that you obey his voice, and that you may cling to him, for he is your life and the length of your days. Father, I thank you for the reading of this word this morning. And as I enter into this, what you've given me to give, I ask, Father, that you open every spiritual eye, that you open every spiritual ear, that they hear this word, Father, that it be a seed and plant into every life. And as it plants, Father, I ask that it be watered by your precious Holy Spirit. And Father, that it'll grow in each and every life, and it'll grow into a plant, and that plant will bear fruit. And Father, we ask for that plant that bears fruit to do more than just bear fruit, but Father, that it bear good fruit in our lives. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
But Father, we ask for more than just good fruit this morning. We ask like we do each week. Father, we ask for good fruit that will remain for the rest of our days, Father, from the message that comes forth this morning. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And everybody says,
amen.
Amen. I want to bring a word this morning that your word is a weapon. But to lay a foundation for where I need to go today, I got to make a few declarations. They're going to upset some of you guys. Some of you are going to get mad at me. How many's got my back? We are in the middle of a political cycle. Somebody say amen. And I don't care if you like Trump or you don't like Trump. I don't care if you like Obama if you don't like Obama. I don't care. Because according to the word of God, everything that takes place in the world and everything that takes place on this earth is ordained by God. All principalities and all powers and all governments. Which means that Obama, whether you like it or not, Obama was ordained by God to hold his position. Now some of you ain't gonna like it. But on the same hand, Trump was ordained to hold the position that he is going to hold. Somebody say amen. Amen. And we as a church and we as a people of God need to stop fussing and fighting over little political things and over who's this and who's that, whether I'm Republican or whether I'm Democrat, whether I'm Libertarian, whether I'm this or I'm that, and realize that we are children of the Most High God, and we don't bow our knee to a government anyway. We bow our knee to our Heavenly Father. Somebody say amen. Pastor Alan, I don't understand what's taking place. I'll tell you exactly what's taking place. There's a time that's a coming. I believe that we're in the end times. I believe that our Lord can split the clouds of glory at any moment. I believe it can take place even before I finish this message today. Even for those that are looking at me right now, like your deer in the headlights, are looking at me right now saying, oh my God, I walked into a crazy church. It was okay when there was a singing, but that preacher up there, he's out of his mind. But that's all right. I come to tell you this morning that something is taking place, and why all these things are taking place is very simple. We are in the end times, and I believe that God is preparing the church right now for an end time revival, not some little political thing that people rise up to write books about so they can make a lot of money so they can buy a big car and another big house, but a revival that starts in the grassroots of the people's hearts. Revivals that aren't starting on a television set or some internet, but revivals that are starting in the houses of God, where people are falling on their face once again and crying out to a holy God. What do you mean, Pastor Allen? I believe it's about to take place. Why do you think that, Pastor? Number one, God needs to finance what he needs to do, not to make a preacher rich and not to put a preacher in a nice home and not to put a preacher in a nice car, but to propagate the gospel of Christ, because people need to hear the gospel of Christ. And you may not like Trump, and you may like Trump, but I can tell you right now, Trump right now has surrounded himself with more Christian influence around his presidency than any president in modern history. So why would he do that? I don't think he's a Christian. I don't know if he's saved or not. He says he has. Every president's been in the White House, including Obama, says they're saved and a Christian. But I ain't never seen the lifestyle prove it. I've never seen any fruit, not in a single one of them, that showed that they were saved and filled with the Holy Spirit. Never seen it. But I can tell you right now, I don't know where Trump is right now, but what I do know right now is he's surrounding himself with Christian influences of men of God. If you don't believe me, he just invited Perry Stone to come up and be at the inaugural with him, because he wanted people that surround him that were pro-Israel. Can I tell you right now, when you begin to bless Israel, and when you begin to reach out to Israel, when you begin to become a friend of Israel, blessing comes into your life. And I'm telling you, we're fixing to walk in a time that things are going to turn around. I know last year I said it was going to be bad, it's going to get a little worse, but I'm telling you, this year there is joy that's coming in the Lord. Now is the time. Man, I promised myself I wasn't going to get crazy this morning.
Come on.
I sit here writing this, and I'm going to change. Woo. I told Chastity, I'm changing the way I'm going. I'm going to do it a little different this morning. And here I am going all over the place, all over again. I apologize. I just can't help it. What are you saying, preacher? I'm saying it is now. It is time, my friend, for a sovereign move of the Holy Ghost revival to break out the house of God. I'm tired of having church as usual. I'm tired of just showing up with our little song and our little sermon, and we make our little times here and there, and we make some time for Jesus when we can make some time for Jesus. Oh, I am hungry for a sovereign move of the Holy Ghost revival. I'm hungry for young men and young women to begin to cry out and begin to prophesy. I am am hungry for a return to the light, a revival spirit. My friend, I am hungry for a revival spirit to begin to break out.
Hallelujah.
I believe that we're going to begin to see this year that Acts 2 is going to come alive back into the church again, where it says in Acts 2, verse 1, and when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting, and then there appeared to them divided tongues as a fire, and it set upon each of them, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit of God gave utterance. Can I tell you this morning, I believe that there is going to be a mighty rushing wind and a suddenly of the Holy Spirit that begins to flood the church again, and I want to be right smack dab in the middle of it. Take it just a little further in Acts 2. We skip down to verse 14. And this is how that move is going to take place. This is how it's going to happen. It says in verse 14 through 18. But Peter, standing up with the 11, raised his voice and said to them, men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and heed my words. For these are not drunk as you suppose. That means, you know what that means? That means they're up there acting like idiots. They're up there just swaying around like this. And they're up there bumping into things. And it wasn't because they're drunk on the wine. It's because they're drunk on the wine of the Holy Ghost. They were drunk in the Spirit. Can I tell you? Oh, that God is going to fall down. And we're going to have people walking around like drunk people. But these are not drunk as you suppose, since it's only the third hour of the day. But this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last days. We are in the last days. And it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And on my men servants and my maid servants, I will pour out my spirit in those days. Can I tell you, there is a rushing mighty wind on the way. I can hear it in the trees. It's beginning to blow. I can feel the tickle of the wind on my skin. Oh, there's a move of God that's just about to manifest. Somebody say amen this morning.
Amen.
Amen.
How's it coming, Pastor? It says right here in verse 17 that our sons and our daughters are going to begin to prophesy. That our young men going to fall on their face before God. And began to cry out to God. And have visions and began to prophesy. That our young ladies are going to begin to cry out to God. And they're going to begin to prophesy. Thank God he went down the second verse and he said his men servant and his maid servants, because God, I guess he's trying to make up, because he said, I'm going to take up the younger group and I'm going to raise them up and I'm going to bring them give them the anointing so they can preach the gospel. And that's all the old dudes over there. At least he come by and said, I'm going to pour out my spirit on them poor old folk at the same time. Amen. I thank God for that. But it's not just going to come through me and come through you. That's why I don't cater everything to the old people or cater everything to the middle age. I cater as much as I can to the youth. You know why? Because it says right here that revival is coming and the Spirit of God is going to rise up. Not out of the old generation, but out of the new generation. Our young men, our young women, they're going to prophesy. They may not prophesy in a fashion that we realize. We may not prophesy in a fashion that we understand. They may get up and they might do a little rap and they might do a little dance and they might what we do it, but I don't care as long as they're prophesying, as long as the atmosphere around their life is creating life and they're bringing life into the house of God. I say prophesy whether you're dancing. I say prophesy whether you're rapping. I say prophesy if you're playing the guitar or you're singing a song. If it's contemporary, if it's hard, if it's soft, if it's Southern gospel, I don't care. I just want you to stand up and prophesy. You better clap better than that. Amen. The devil tried his best. But I came to declare to you this morning that his best was not good enough.
Amen.
I heard a song the other day that none of you guys in this church would like. Because they got crazy.
Yeah, come on now.
This guy got to singing and jumping and running. He's a black brother. He got singing and jumping and running and a hollering and a wailing and turning around. He hit the floor. He was jumping around. He started doing some bow legs. I don't even know what he was doing. He was doing something. I know my bones don't move like that. And he got up and he was going, and the Holy Ghost was all over him. And he was dancing and he was singing and he was getting on it. And he was doing a little song called Turn It. And I began to read some of the words. And I took it in Alan Baggett style and said, you know what? I can't do it the way he did. But I want to give you some of the words that he used, and I transformed them to a little bit of Alan Baggett knees. Is that all right?
Come on, yeah. Come on now.
This is an Alan Baggett translation. This is in the King James, the New King James, or NIV, or the Living. This is Alan Baggett translation. The devil thought he had me. He thought I would have quit by now. He thought there was no more strength inside of me. But that's when someone greater stepped up and opened the door. Jesus inserted into my situation and divinity invaded my circumstance. But someone greater than the storm was around me, overwhelmed that which intended to overwhelm me. Oh, the devil thought that he had me. He thought that I would have quit by now. He thought there was no more strength left inside of me. But that's when someone greater stepped up and he opened the door. There were times in my life when I thought I would have never made it. I almost went down. I almost went down for the count. But what hell had meant for evil, God turned around for my good. The devil thought that it had me. He thought I would have quit by now. But that's when someone greater stepped up and opened the door. The Christ, Son of the living God, Jesus Christ, my Lord. Somebody say amen. The devil thought he had me.
Yeah.
Hey, come on.
He thought for sure I'd quit by now. But I got news for you, yo slew tooth, pointed tail, little pointed ear, little pointed shoe toe thing, you with your little roach killers on your feet. I speak to you right now, and I said, I ain't quitting. I ain't going down. I ain't down for the quiet count. Oh, you thought you had me. You thought I was down. But I tell you right now, I opened the door, and there was somebody at the door greater than you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah!
Come on now, hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
Now that's the Holy Ghost.
Come on,
You say, what's that got to do with anything, Pastor? What's that got to do with what you're talking about? I had to lay a foundation because your word is a weapon. Your word is your weapon. And it's very important in this year 2017. In the Hebrew calendar, no, I'm not going to go to the Hebrew calendar. In the Hebrew alphabet, let me go there. In the Hebrew alphabet, each letter has a specific numerical value and a specific word value. And these values never change. They're exactly the same as they were when they were first written. When they first created the alphabet, it's the same then as it is today. It didn't modify like our dictionaries do.
Nope.
How many know that you can say one word today and it means something else? Amen?
Amen.
I was doing something with Chastin the other day. And we was working on a design for the new t-shirt company. We're going to launch in the spring, and every one of y'all need to jump on Chastin's website and start getting those shirts. They're going to be the hottest thing in the United States. What you laughing at? They are. I already spoke of it. I need a boy to make some money and take care of me in my old age. I'm speaking all over that thing. Well, he came up with something. I looked at it and said, man, I'm getting old because I never thought of that. I come up with the designs. And everybody says, oh, that's nice for a senior citizen shirt, Taddy. Chastin comes up with something that looks weird. I look at it and say, what in the world is that? And then Danae and Elena and other people come in and look at it and they go, oh, wow, that's awesome. I'm going, what is it? But he came up with the design the other day and I went and looked at it. And I said, hey, you know what? I actually like that one. That's pretty good. You don't want me to give any of your secrets away, right? You told me not to say anything. Okay, I won't say anything about it. Other than what I just did. No details. But I looked at it, I said, man, that's pretty good. I like that one. I said, in fact, on these shirts you're doing right here, I want to do a sermon series on each one of them. And wouldn't it be good to have a series of shirts where we have a devotional, a spoken word, and a sermon, and a Bible study that goes along with the t-shirt, because the t-shirt's a biblical shirt. And it's just not a knockoff of some trend somewhere. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
But I looked at it and I said, man, that's great. I like that one. I really like that one. He said, yeah, man, it is sick, isn't it, dude? This thing is sick. Man, that thing ain't sick. I like it. I think it looks good. I know he said it's sick. And I said, Chastin, now we're coming into a new year. You got to come in here and speak good things and positive things. You need to look at your designs and say, they're good and they're going to prosper. He said, that's what I'm saying, Daddy. They're sick. I said, what do you mean? He said, Daddy, sick means good. And I said, buddy, not where I grew up from. When you got sick, you went down to the grocery store and got some cough medicine or something. You drank down the cough medicine, went down to the doctor. But nowadays, when you're sick, you're good. So I guess that when you're feeling good, you must be sick. I don't understand it. But in the Hebrew, it means the same. It doesn't change. It doesn't change. It stays the same. So having that in mind, we're in the year 2017. So I want to take a look at two numbers for this word that God has placed inside of my spirit.
Amen.
See how much time I got to go. Oh, yeah, I got 2 hours left. You better stop saying that. Nobody likes you anymore because you keep saying that. Well, my wife, she told me to tell you to quit saying 5 hours. She said to tell you six. Numbers in the Hebrew in the Hebrew culture are very important. They mean something. They're meant to be prophetic. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
So we're in the year 2017. So I want us to look at two numbers. I want us to look at the number 17. Which is 2000 what? And the last number, 2017, is what?
Eight.
It's seven. Seven. 2017 is seven. We're also in the Jewish calendar. It's the year. It's the year 5077. We're not even going to talk about that. But we're in the, it's in the year 5077 in the Hebraic calendar. Yeah. In that calendar. But right now in our calendar, we're at 2017. The 17th letter of the Hebrew alphabet is the letter Pei. If y'all just hold on, I'm going to lay a foundation. I'm going to take it somewhere.
Amen.
Is the letter Pei. And that word Pei is defined as mouth. So anywhere you see the letter Pei, it deals with the mouth. How many of you in this house have a mouth?
Everybody.
There's a few of you that don't. How many of this house have a mouth? I know some of you have a mouth because you run it all the time. The word paid, the 17th letter, 2017, is the word mouth. So in essence, this is the year of the mouth. But the letter pay has two different forms. It has an... And when it's used out through the in Hebrew, it has two forms. It has an open form and it has a closed form. In other words, you have an open mouth and you have a what? You have a closed mouth. Why is that so important? Because there's going to be times in this year that you need to speak out. There's going to be times in this year that you need to make confession and make declaration unto God. You listen to this preacher right now. This is a time of year. This is a year that's going to take place right now. Oh, that with the things that we've been speaking out, the things that we've been asking for, the things that we've been looking for are going to begin to come to pass, because this is the year of the mouth. The things that come out of our mouth are going to begin to take place, and there's going to be a time that we need to be shouting. There's going to be a time when our mouths need to be open and we need to be speaking, and there's going to be times that we need to shut up and shut our mouths. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes, there's a time for everything under the sun, every season, everything. There's a time to dance. There's a time to cry. There's a time to speak. And there's a time, in Alan Baggett language, it's a time to speak and a time to shut up. All the kids are back there, so I can say shut up. You can't say shut up in my house. That's a bad word. So they're all back there right now. There's a time to talk, and there's a time to shut your stinking mouth. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
But when you open your mouth this year, if you began to speak trouble, guess what you're going to get? If you began to speak cursings, guess what you're going to get? You walk into your job and you're going, I don't like my job. I don't like my boss. I don't like all that. You know what? You better, it's a time to open your mouth, a time to shut your mouth. When all that mess is coming out of your mouth, it's time to shut your mouth. I don't care if your boss is not good to you, and I don't care if he does something wrong to you. You know what? Unless he's not paying you at the end of the week, you better keep your mouth shut, because when you begin to curse that man and you begin to curse him and begin to curse that job, then you're going to get exactly what you've been speaking, and you ain't going to have a job no more. And you're going to come up to Pastor Allen and say, can you make a little offering for us so I can pay my bills? And I said, well, you shouldn't have been cursing your job in the first place, and we wouldn't have to take God's money to pay your electric bill.
Come on now. Come on.
I lost all my amens.
Amen.
You walk in that job, you don't like your boss, and you don't like your job, and you don't like what's going on in that job, and you don't like the situation, then you walk in there and you say, you know what, I don't like him and he's getting all over me. That's what. But don't let that come out of your mouth. Don't let that build up in your heart. You walk in there and say, you know what, he ain't doing me right, but God, I just ask that you bless him. Oh God, just bless his business, bless everything he puts his hands on, God. Oh, bless his family, bless his health. God, give him a new car, give him a new home. Oh, just give him all the other thing he needs, God. Just bless his business. You know, why would I do that? Because don't you understand, man, when he gets blessed and he's got more than enough, that you're going to get blessed too, and you're going to get a raise, and you're going to get some more money. And if he finds out that you're a good worker that don't give any problems, he might even give you a promotion.
That's right.
Amen. Boy, I lost all my amens. You ain't getting along with your wife. You ain't getting along with your husband. You go over there and look at them and say, that old nasty thing, lazy thing laying in around all day, bless God, sitting there. He ain't worth no count, blah, 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 blah. Guess what you're going to get this year? You're going to get a lazy, no good man that's laying around all year, going blah, 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 all year, because that's exactly what you said. You walk up to that man, and I know he might not be manifesting in here right now. Somebody say amen. He may not be man. Not saying you're this way, John. I told you, he's in a bad place. You walk up to that man, he said, oh, he's sitting there watching football, and he needs to be taking out the trash. He needs to be doing something around the house, but he's watching football. That old man, nasty man sitting there. Oh, but walk up to him and say, oh, I see a man of God in you. I know that you're going to take that garbage out. I know you're going to go over and fix that sink. I know you're going to fix that leaky shower. Oh, leaky shower. That's right. Amen. I know Chastity's going to fix that leaky shower. Amen. I know that old lazy man's going to do it. And began to speak something positive and see what begins to take place. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
You speak blessings. And you're going to get blessings.
That's right.
Because this is the year of the mouth.
Yep.
What comes out of your mouth is going to be made manifest. And I don't know about you, but I've had enough defeat. I've had enough cursing. I've had enough sickness. I've had enough poverty. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
I've had enough of depression, and I've had enough of drama all around my life. I've had enough of all that stuff. I'm ready for a little joy. I'm ready for a little prosperity. I'm ready for a little something good to take place in my life. How's it going to happen, Pastor? I'm going to open my mouth, and I'm going to begin to make a declaration unto God. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, it may be raining all around. The overwhelmer may be trying to knock my door down, but when I answer that door, my God, who is bigger than the storm and the circumstance, is going to be at that door. Hallelujah, in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I'm going to let something pour out of my mouth. I got to watch my pay. I ain't talking about your paycheck. I'm talking about your mouth. The second letter I want to look at is the seventh letter, which can be lucky seven, which can be pronounced lion or zane. It's according to what dialect you use.
That's right.
And that word is literally defined. Remember, we're dealing with the two sevens.
Yep.
It's literally defined as a sword. The word Zane, the word picture there is sword. So in this year, our mouth, what comes out of our mouth will be like a sword. A sword that comes out of our mouth that cuts down. A sword that comes out of our mouth that destroys. A sword that comes out of our mouth that cuts down and destroys the enemy.
Come on.
Amen.
But this sword can be used to cut down and destroy the enemy. But this sword can be used to bring destruction instead of deliverance.
Yeah, that's right.
Be careful what you say. It depends on what comes out of your mouth. But the interesting thing about this word right here is that that this form of sword is not only regulated for battle swords. It also refers to a surgical tool that can cut out and remove things that need to be cut out and removed. In other words, what's taking place in this year right here in the word of the mouth, as we began to make declaration, as we began to speak out, as we began to do what we need to do, as we open our mouth and we begin to make the right confessions to God, when we speak out and we begin to pray for our family and we begin to pray for our kids and we begin to pray for our finances and we begin to pray for the things that are around us, that a sword will come out of our mouth. Oh, and it's not just a sword to do battle with the enemy, but that sword, as we begin to speak those things, are going to come out, and it's going to be a Holy Ghost surgical tool that comes down into our life and begins to cut out the areas and the parts of our life that are in us that need to be removed, the habits that need to be removed, the attitudes that need to be removed, the negativity that needs to be removed, the sickness that needs to be removed, all the junk that needs to be removed, the drama that needs to be removed, all the things, as we begin to speak out and make declaration and fall on our face before God, oh, and let the word come out of our mouth, and we begin to speak, it's going to begin to cut, it's going to hurt a little bit, the devil ain't going to like it, but when everything is said and done, and we get to the end of this year, you're going to look back, and you're going to say, my God is faithful. My God is good. He has been with me, and you are going to be blessed beyond any measure that you could expect if you're obedient, if you're walking in His way, if you're doing right and making right confession. I'm telling you, this is a year that we're going to see prosperity. We're going to see miracles left and right.
Amen.
You think I'm crazy? I got things I want to tell you right now, but I can't. I'm not going to tell you till they may manifest. There's things that we need to do, and we need to do. One thing we need to do is going to cost about $8,000. I don't have $8,000. The church doesn't have $8,000. But I just had a meeting with a guy the other day, and he said, you know what? I like what you're talking about. I think it's a good idea. He said, you go pick out the stuff. You figure out what you need to do, and I'll cover it. That's just one thing. We're just getting through the first week of the new year, and God's already opening doors. God's already making things happen. Things are already taking place, and we ain't even got started yet. Can you imagine? Look at the house this morning. Can you imagine? We got a lot of folks that aren't here this morning because they're sick. A lot of families aren't here because the new year has been so cold, and they're stuck. And we got a lot of people here. If we had everybody here right now, we wouldn't even have enough seats to put everybody in the house. I tell you, we just started the year out. We just getting started. God is on the move. And if you begin to make a good profession, I'm telling you, God is going to do something to you this year that you can't even imagine. This year, we need to be prepared for a Holy Ghost revival. A revival of restoration. And I ain't putting it on the books. I ain't calling in some fancy bigwig come in. We'll do that sooner or later. But I don't want a revival that's based off of personality. I want a God revival. Not that God can't move through a personality, but I don't want people coming to worship. Man, I want people coming to worship God. And as we begin to build up and revival spirits here and a move of the Holy Ghost, then we can start thinking about that. Yeah. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
I believe before this year's out, one Sunday we're going to be in this building and the power of God's going to come down in such a way that we're going to say, you know what? We need to carry this on over to Sunday night and we're going to get through a Sunday night. And you're going to say, you know what? We need to carry this on to Monday night and we're going to carry it over to Monday night. And we say, you know what? We need to carry this on to Tuesday night and we're going to carry it over to Tuesday night. And the house is going to fill up and we're going to say, you know what? We need to carry those away. And we just carry it on to God's finish. That's the kind of revival I'm talking about. I'm not talking about something we put on the book. I'm talking about a Holy Ghost revival or restoration that the people of God fall on the face and the Holy Ghost sweeps this building. I pray for it and I speak it forth now in the name of Jesus. Let it be so. As you begin to speak forth, the devil ain't going to like it. When your body begins to start healing, he ain't going to like that. When your finances begin to turn around, he ain't going to like it. When you get offered that promotion or more money, he ain't going to like it. Somebody listen. So you're going to have to fight for what you need, and you're going to have to fight for what you believe. But that's why I gave that illustration just a little bit earlier. That the devil thought he'd got me. But I ain't down yet. There's somebody bigger at my door than any circumstance or drama or anything else. It's coming, but I'm going to have to fight for it. But can I tell you right now, as hard as I preach and as hard as I sing, I'm going to stare the devil right between the eyes and I'm going to fight for everything that my family needs and everything that God wants to deliver my family. And not only my family, I'm going to fight for this guy. I'm going to fight for this guy right here. And I'm going to fight for him tooth and toenail. Is he perfect? No, he ain't perfect. But are you perfect? No, you ain't perfect. So if you don't like him, shut up your mouth. Nobody said they don't like you, nothing like that. He's thinking, who said they didn't like me? No, nobody said that. Prepare for a Holy Ghost revival because it's going to hit this year.
Amen.
And we're not going to have to make it happen. It's going to happen. You're going to have to fight for your blessing, but that blessing's coming.
Amen.
And number three, we have to watch what comes out of our mouth. Because this is a year that what we speak is going to be made manifest in our lives.